Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have a very unique show. I've got two people that are associated with Forbes today. Ken Fisher is the billionaire genius behind Fisher Investments, and he has some really interesting insights on all different kinds of topics today. I got to ask him some things about the election prior to the election, so you'll note that that was taped prior, that part, but I think it's still so relevant. Everything you talked about in terms of career and personalities and a lot of things that you wouldn't normally think of, we talked about. So I think that that was a really great interview. And also John Tamny, who is also political editor at Forbes and is an author, and both Ken Fisher and John Tamny are authors. And they're very interesting, totally different interviews. And I hope that you stick around for this show because it's unlike any other. And we will be back.
Attend any corporate summit, and it's likely someone will bring up issues with millennials or other generational conflict. In the book, It's Not You, It's Your Personality, the authors explore the post-boomer generations and how to use personality assessments to get along in the modern workplace. Learn what makes the younger workforce unique. Filled with tips, tricks, and techniques, It's Not You, It's Your Personality outlines various scenarios with different personalities to give you a more detailed look at how different people can more effectively work together, both in team situations and when various activities require them to better understand one another. You'll learn how to recognize character traits in others, as well as in yourself, and what to do about the traits that need help. Entertaining as well as educational, It's Not You, It's Your Personality makes understanding personality assessment essential to workplace success. To get your copy, text the word Diane, D-I-A-N-E, to 38470. That's Diane, D-I-A-N-E, at 38470.
Have a lot of questions for you, so we'll just have a conversation.
Great. No problem.
I'm Dr. Diane Hamilton, and this is Ken Fisher.
Hi.
Hi, and we're just going to have a conversation. And we're going to talk about some stuff that you might not get a chance to talk about today in your talk.
So okie dokie.
Just had a few questions. I've seen some of your interviews.
I'm nicer than that.
Are you?
Yeah,
you seem nicer.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Well, so far, things are going well. But I just...
I haven't even gotten to profanity, you see?
Well, it is early.
We have time.
We have time. But I think we've been talking a lot about different issues that in the car. We were talking about millennials and different things, which I'm very interested in. But there's a lot of courses that I teach at Ashford and the Forbes School of Business that deal with leadership management differences in that and the born or made discussion of leaders are born or made. And you're obviously a very successful leader. You seem to me to have a personality that probably was always there that made you strong. I'm curious, do you agree with that? And are you born or made? And do you think that there's anything to that?
I don't really know. Let me say that in my life, most of the best books that I've ever read were old. And most of the new books that I've read weren't so good. But a few are. And a recent book, the book Quiet by Susan Cain, taught me a lot about myself, both in terms of my evolution as a person and kind of who I am. And a lot of the key to life is, as we were saying in the car, wise choices, keen observations, modified to the keen observations while maintaining wise choices. And a lot of that wise choice part's really about knowing yourself. And I don't know that everybody's all the same. So it actually may be there's a place for the person that's born a certain way and doesn't really change, and also for the person that modifies. I've changed a lot in my life. And I think probably both exist pretty much in the world. I don't know, the world's all one type of thing.
Would you consider yourself an introvert if that
I'm completely an introvert.
Quiet is
about
that. Yeah,
quiet's about introvert versus extrovert.
Right.
And I'm very much an introvert. I've always been very much an introvert. That's, as the book talks about, learns how to deal with people and crowds.
It's a lot of people have cited that book as very popular.
Book. It's a great book.
I think a lot of the courses I teach are entrepreneurial.
Of course, that book is biased in that it's biased to be pro-introvert.
Right.
But if you read it, you can read it just from the viewpoint of the differentiation between introvert and extrovert, and the key is to knowing yourself and then take advantage of the strengths that you have in what you are and modify against the weaknesses.
Well, you know, I've taught a lot of classes where are entrepreneurial based, where we talk about the introverts versus extroverts, and also I've spoken to groups about interviewing once they've got their degree and how to interview if you're an introvert and you're interviewing with an extrovert and vice versa. I'm a total extrovert, and I'll talk all over you if you're interviewing with me and won't give you a chance to answer because I'm thinking you're not listening or you're not, you know, talking fast enough to answer what I'm thinking, just because that's how I would do it. So do you think we need to do more training to explain to the introverts and extroverts how to deal with one another, and does it make a big difference in the interview process, do you
how
think?
How to deal with one another, I wouldn't define that way. In my mind, that part I define in knowing yourself. Always knowing yourself is the most important thing, and most people don't really put enough time into understanding who they really are and aren't really very good at looking at themselves. To help with both the looking at yourself and also with the getting along with others, and I might say this later on, I'm very big on what I refer to as Burnsian psychology, which is all the stuff that kind of came out of Eric Burns and his book Games People Play, and Anthony Harris's I'm Okay, You're Okay, and Muriel James' is Born to Win, which is largely about transactional analysis and how that helps you with the other people. But unlike what you would say, I was trained by a guy who's now not around anymore, unfortunately, great guy, to largely shut the F up when I'm interviewing people. Yeah. And I've actually brought people, I don't interview well, I've never been a very good interviewer, but when I'm interviewing an employee, which I don't really do and haven't done for a long time to everyone's benefit, but my firm's always been trained to do this way, I've actually brought people to tears by my silence because they think there's something wrong there and I'm trying to get them to talk. And my view is, and then they try to merchandise to you. Mm-hmm. And my view is, if I'm the employer, merchandising to me is the wrong thing. And I go back to, people don't get this, but the most important single thing is, I mean, resumes are useless when you get right down to it. What's really useful is what people will do, not what they can do. What they can do is pointless. And the way you assess to some extent what they will do is by what they do. So, you know, I'll ask somebody a question like, so tell me what you did yesterday. And then they'll start off by trying to merchandise to me. And I'll say, no, when you woke up, what'd you do? And then what'd you do 15 minutes after that? And then what'd you do 15 minutes after that? And then in the next hour, what'd you do? And you just keep getting them to go through what they actually do. And if they get off of that, I take them back to that, which annoys them because that's not what they want to do. They want to merchandise.
Right.
And you know, again, from my view, merchandising is not something that's useful to the firm. What they will do is what's useful to the firm.
Even if you're hiring salespeople?
What they will, particularly if you're hiring salespeople. Mm-hmm. I mean, the reality of sales is it's attitude and activity equals success. And salespeople often can be all over the board in terms of what you could view as a BS factor. And what really matters is what they will do.
Right.
And so therefore, I mean, to be a really successful salesperson, you gotta be positive attitude, high activity. And you gotta be able to enjoy that and keep that going. And that does not matter whether you're an introvert or an extrovert, because, you know, salespeople are successful both ways, although there are more extroverts in sales than there are introverts. Mm-hmm. Some super successful salespeople are just keenly focused introverts. And, you know, it's all about what they will do. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's things you can tell about, for example, the salesperson. If a salesperson interviews and they want to sit quietly in a chair for a long time, they're probably not a salesperson.
Right.
I mean, salespeople want to get up, they want to move, they want to be doing. They don't want to, They don't mind sitting in the car to drive to an appointment, but they do not want to be sitting there doing nothing. They want to go. Mm-hmm. And if they don't have activity in them, it's what they will do, not what they can do.
You know, we talked about something in the car.
Can do is necessary, but it's not sufficient.
You were talking about just the different types of personalities, which remind me of our conversation we had in the car about how you don't want to put people into groups so much. And I'm
in favor of putting people into groups, but just not in these kinds of ways. I mean, for example, I'm totally in favor of having prisons and putting people there. Stuff like that is all fine. There's all kinds of groups.
Yes.
I think lawyers should belong to the Bar Association, all that kind of stuff.
Within the workplace, though, categorizing people as a certain age group or a certain type of personality or a certain thing. I was in sales for 25 years, and I had one company where they gave us a personality assessment. Mm-hmm. And we had to take our results and put them on our cubicle. So you're either a red, a blue, a green, or a yellow. So people knew what you were. That sounds like it'd be opposed to what you would think would be appropriate based on our conversation in the car. What do you
really
think of that?
I don't know that any of that stuff really works real well. I'm going to go back to maybe people know things about that I don't know. And if they know how to do that and make it work, more power to them. Mm-hmm. So again, I'm going to go back to, I was trained on hiring by a particular guy from Montana University with a particular mindset. And his point was hiring is very imperfect. You really look at, do they have the attributes that might succeed for this function? And if they do, you kind of throw them in the water. And if you're a really good hirer, you're right about 60% of the time, if you do that, and not more than that. And if you're a really bad hirer and you do that, you're right about 40% of the time. And so then once you hire them, you have to be ready to prune pretty fast to see once you get them. I mean, when you interview people, you talk to them a little bit. Mm-hmm. How much do you really know about them after that? Not that much. So the reality is it's necessarily imperfect. And that imperfection bleeds over into the ones that can actually figure out how to game you. And get by, you know, if you think, for you were talking about sales, if you think about sales, how they look really isn't important. Mm-hmm. Our all-time number one salesperson ever does not look, who actually comes from Texas, does not look like something special. He is something special. We have people that look like something special, and some of them are, and some of them aren't, because it doesn't even do with anything.
It's interesting to see the people that make it in sales. When I was in pharmaceutical sales, I can remember calling on a doctor's office where the doctor told me that they wrote this my competitor's product. And I said, but why? You told me how many times you dislike this person. And he said he hated him. I mean, he just couldn't stand him. But he said because he was in his mind so much because he was there all the time. So, you know, you just don't know what's going to be the thing that's going to work.
In sales, I don't know, you know, you're asking about sales and talking about sales, so that's fine. But in sales, there's a million different books on selling. There's different approaches to selling. I don't have anything for or against them, any of them, particularly. I don't think there's one way to sell, per se. Again, that comes back to the salesperson fitting all of those techniques into who he or she is, and the key being knowing who he or she is. And I've known salespeople that didn't know who they were that were still very successful because they were driven. And ultimately, the summary formula that I always come back to is A&A equals S, activity and attitude equals success. And I mean, I remember one salesperson that's now retired, very, very successful, driven, and a little bit like you say, an awful lot of people didn't like this man. But that never stopped him because he just kept moving forward.
Tenacious.
And a strong salesperson looks at all those different sales techniques and books that are available and says, I couldn't do that, but I could do that. I couldn't do this, but I could do this. And, oh boy, look at that, wow. And they pick off the shelf what they can use and they leave the rest behind and you let them do that. And if they've got the will do in them, they will succeed. Now, what I just said also applies to everything that isn't sales. It also applies to service. It also applies to every other part of an enterprise. And the reality of that one guy that I was mentioning, he used to like to touch people a lot. a lot of people don't like being touched, right? You know, when you reach over and you touch the people and you touch the people and you touch the people and you touch the people. A lot of people like that. A lot of people don't like that.
Right.
None of that ever stopped him. You could have hit him over the head with a 2x4 and he would just kept moving forward.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Attitude. Activity.
Well, okay, so you touched on things that to be successful. You're obviously successful. And I'd like to know, what did you do yesterday? And then 15 minutes later, that's the kind of questions I wanted to ask you, which is kind of funny that you brought that up to me.
Because so yesterday, early in the morning, I got on a plane and I flew to Dallas.
Okay.
And the plane arrived in Dallas. That was good.
That's always good.
And then I got off the plane and I'm with some other people and we were looking at real estate in Dallas to put a facility into Dallas because Dallas is the next place that we're going to put an operational facility for the firm.
So are your days similar? Or are they very different every day? I mean, what is it
My
like
days
to be
are
you?
Not similar, but I'm in a different position than most people. I travel a fair amount. Mm-hmm. I do a fair amount of communication. So one day might be in the office, in front of my workstation at 6 a.m., looking at things online, communicating emails in the first half hour with things from our overseas operations, and then meetings through the day, in the office, talking to people, on the phone, in person. Another day might be traveling on a plane for a long time. In the last month I did a 45-hour turnaround to Frankfurt. Which is a long time on the plane for that amount of time, but that means a lot of reading, right? And so I kind of batch my reading on the plane. My days are more varied than most people's.
Well, but you've gotten to a point that most people never achieve. How do you think? What did you do differently?
Only if they choose to. It's their choices.
Well, there's not as many billionaires in the world.
Well, no. That's a different issue completely. I mean, I wouldn't view the world that way. You know, you don't really measure success in money. Some people may, but
some
I think that's not necessarily the right way to do it.
Right.
I was as much of a success 20 years ago when I wasn't nearly as theoretically wealthy as I am today because I was founder, CEO. I was doing, my world wasn't very different than it is today in terms of the things that I did. And people can make those choices on their own. I wouldn't say that they can make those choices on their own successfully, usually when they're very young, but at a point in time, if it were up to me, I mean, I never would have been a good employee. I never would have been a good employee. I think that the choices that I made are choices that anybody could make.
What do you think was your most important choice that's set all in motion?
Getting married.
Well, of course.
I mean, that's the most important choice.
Yes.
That's
pretty simple.
I want to go back to what I said in the car, what I said earlier.
Okay.
The key to success in life, more than anything else, is wise choices, keen observations, and recognizing that your observations are often wrong and modifying when they're wrong. Wise in the choices, the wisdom part, an awful lot of people suffer on. The ability to be a keen observer, an awful lot of people think they're keen observers, but they don't analyze their own observations, and they have a very hard time saying, I was wrong. Most successful CEOs that I've ever known, of all stripes, make decisions easily, recognize when they're wrong easily, and modify easily. They'll be stubborn about their values,
right?
Which is that wisdom part, but they'll see, I thought this would work, it doesn't work, I'm scuttling it and moving on. This part's working, let it run, let it go. That's pretty basic to whether you're, you know, a CEO of a smaller organization that's succeeding to your satisfaction, or whether at a larger scale you're, once upon a time, Bill Gates or Steve Jobs.
You've always been directed, though, in a financial way, though. Your degree's in economics, correct?
Yes.
Do you think that that is important to go into a specific degree program to help
depends
with your
you
success?
Depends what you want to do. I mean, if you want to be a doctor, you better
go
be very specific in that. I think it's Some areas you need to do that. Some areas
what
you
about
don't
your
need,
area?
Oh no, no. I think in my area, let me just say, and I'm presuming that many of the people that will hear whatever we're talking about today mm-hmm. will be your students. Mm-hmm. And functionally, education is necessary, but it's not sufficient because most of what you'll ever learn in your life, you learn as informal education after you've completed your formal education.
Right.
Because it's a long life. Students always have a tough time assessing how long life is. It just keeps going, hopefully. I mean, hopefully. And if it doesn't, then the rest of the education didn't matter too much.
Right.
So fundamentally, at its core, the reality is that this goes back to the point that you're learning after you complete the K-12, mm-hmm. after you complete the university, after you complete any graduate work that you may do in whatever your field is. And the most important part of education is really learning to learn. And because you're going to keep hopefully learning the rest of your life, the lesson of my observation in life from the time that I was young, when I was young, students decided early on to go college track or the trades.
Right.
And most of the people that went into the trades got wiped out by technology. There's still trades. I mean, we still need carpenters and we still need electricians and what have you. But you know, the world of a plumber got simplified by changes in technology and basic plumbing compared to taking iron pipe and sweat fitting it in the days when I was young. Mm-hmm. And auto mechanics, that world, largely gotten wiped out. An awful lot of, the Maytag repairman that was ubiquitous when I was a kid, that world mm-hmm. wiped out. The trades have gone away largely, and yet even an awful lot of the college-educated world gets wiped away if it doesn't keep building its human capital, modifying, changing. The world that we live in today is one of modifying and changing, and it will be more so in the future than in the past. And that's one that speaks to that long life, continuing to learn, continuing to observe, modify. And I think that speaks to, and from my view, and this is something that you say this and you annoy people, but normal university in Harvard mm-hmm. or Stanford on the high end are just broke. I mean, those degrees today are largely, and I don't mean going to medical school mm-hmm. at Stanford
right.
or Harvard. I mean getting a bachelor's degree in most subjects isn't worth anything. It's more, when I say it isn't worth anything, of course it's worth something, but it's more or less the equivalent to a bad high school education in 1910.
Okay, so what would you suggest instead?
That the best education is getting beat up by the world.
Yeah. But what if the employers value education still and they don't look at you without it?
Stupid employers have stupid things as their outcomes.
Yes, yes.
The reality is if, let's go back to things that I said earlier. Resumes aren't important. Mm-hmm. Will do is important. Mm-hmm. If the employer values resume over will do, mm-hmm. the employer's going to have a bad outcome.
So how much training do you offer your
employees? Oh, lots. Literally, fundamentally, after you get finished with your formal education, you begin to learn about the real world. Some people, like a lot of Ashford students, are older and they're going back to school and they've already been learning about the real world
right.
mm-hmm. in the interim. But if you think of the 22-year-old college graduate, they're just learning to learn, and then they're going to go out into the world, and they're going to keep learning. And they're told in school, which is just patently false, that when they get finished with their Stanford degree, the world's going to want them. Mm-hmm. And in reality, when they get finished with their 22-year-old bachelor's degree, the world is going to treat them with its own interests, not with their interests.
Well, once, say they go to school and they have their degree, how would you utilize that the best to get employers to see the value in it? Is it up to the student to, you say, not market in the interview? So how do they get the most out of what they've learned and showcase that if they're coming to you with a degree? Or do you just completely have that?
I don't worry about the resume part. I mm-hmm. wouldn't worry about the resume part. Mm-hmm. If I was the student, I'd be just totally 100% responsive to what the interviewer's asking.
Okay,
interview asks a question, you answer the question.
What do you think is an important question that they should ask in an interview for your company?
I mean, if I were a young person, simply say, can you tell me about the interview process?
Just say that to the interviewer.
Can you tell me about the interview process? Mm-hmm. How would this work here if I was to be hired? What would the process be? And, oh, by the way, along the way, will it be possible for me to meet any employees? And what is it that I can do that best helps your firm?
Those are really good questions. I think that I know a lot of employers get interested that you've done research about the company. I mean, is that important to you if you're talking to a potential employee that they know a lot about your company?
Nope.
You don't want them.
I don't think they can really know a lot about our company.
Is it secret?
No, there's nothing secret about it. It's just, you know, they only know what they see on, how do I say this most simply?
Please don't say Wikipedia.
No, but people will turn to things like that.
I know.
And I don't believe most of what I read in media. Mm-hmm. So if you don't believe most of what you read in the media, mm-hmm. I mean, let me just give you an example of this. This is the part where a person going to school is going to have a hard time getting to the reality of what you could think of as, and I don't mean secret sauce like it's a secret, but the mm-hmm. juice of what makes a business succeed or fail. Fundamentally, you turn on a given time period, your TV in, you put Fox News on record, and you watch CNN at the same time, and then the moment the CNN show is over, you go back to the recording on Fox News, and you see how they covered the same topics. And you wouldn't think you were talking
right.
about the same reality
it's
whatsoever.
Really
I mean, if you just put those two together like that on the same topic, they will be covered so differently, or they won't be covered at all. And what you know intuitively is that those two venues are both playing to a marketplace.
Mm-hmm.
And they both understand who their customer is, mm-hmm. and they're pandering to that marketplace with what I would view as fiction disguised as nonfiction.
Mm-hmm.
And our country and much of the world likes fiction disguised as nonfiction. That's what reality TV is, fiction disguised as nonfiction. It's popular. People mm-hmm. like it. They like it better than the concept sometimes of straight fiction, unless the straight fiction is done very well. And, I was reading a marvelous piece this morning from John Tamny, who I believe has spoken at one of these before mm-hmm. at my suggestion. And John's writing about the uselessness of patents. Because his point is, if you've really got a novel idea at this day and age, you don't have to worry about people stealing it from you. If it's really good, they're going to think it's stupid until you've taken most of their customers away. And the reality is trying to keep them from stealing it from you is a pointless activity. You're going to have to ram it down their throats by stealing, I mean, those are the words he used, ram it down their throats by stealing their customer away. And he mm-hmm. cites lots of examples of that. But that's fundamentally true. And John oversees their Real Clear sites, Forbes Real Clear sites, Real Clear Politics,
right.
Real Clear Markets, Real Clear Sports, all that stuff, Real Clear Science. And that's fundamentally true. The reality of getting to what you asked about, which is the student understanding what's really inside and makes a firm work,
mm-hmm.
you know, they're going to hear all this nonsense that they're going to get from the media, and that's likely to distract them. If I were them, I'd be just more direct, which is, you know, I looked a little bit about your firm, but I really don't know that much.
Mm-hmm.
What is it that I should know about your firm? And let them tell you, as opposed to trying to play like you know a lot.
Right.
When you're interviewing, you don't know a lot.
Right.
When you're interviewing as a potential employee, you don't know a lot.
If
you try to act like you do, it comes off as phony.
It does. It does. I think some employers like to see the initiative that somebody's looked into.
In my opinion, there's plenty of ways in life to assess somebody's initiative. An initiative is good, but playing phony, if the potential employer that's doing the interview thinks that doing phony gamesmanship is a great way for an employee to behave, I think they got bad outcomes waiting for them. If you want to hire a phony, you get phony.
Well, that's interesting because I've heard just so many theories on this, and obviously you've
mind you, Diane, mm-hmm. different firms are different, so I'm not sure that the things that I'm advocating necessarily are good for all different firms.
Mm-hmm. But for your firm, that's what you found.
For my firm, my experience is if you hire phony, you get phony. Why is phony good? I mean, I'm in financial services. Financial services is full of phony. It's the death of financial services firms. It's the death of customers. Mm-hmm. It's bad.
Yeah.
Bad is a formalized finance phrase. They specialize in bad.
Well, I don't know if you're going to get into too much of your financial discussions today, but I was looking at some of your interviews that you talked about, the third year of the presidency being traditionally good for the market.
Sure.
What do you say for the fourth year? I never got to find anything that's what you say for that.
So there's several things you can say about that. If you look at the 4 years of a president's term, traditionally the fourth year is not as good as the third year, but it's better than the first and second. The first and second are extraordinarily variable. Very high returns or very low returns most of the time in the first or second year. In the fourth year, presidential election year, the year we are in now but coming to an end soon, so these comments are about to be obsolete.
Right.
There's two basic things you can say. One, the back half of the year tends to be positive about 80% of the time, which is statistically a lot more than markets normally are. Secondarily, U.S. outperforms non-U.S. about 80% of the time. I believe both of those, understanding what is always easier than why in anything,
mm-hmm.
I believe the why, I can't prove that the why, is driven by falling uncertainty. That is,
right.
As we start the year, we have a lot of uncertainty about who will be the nominees, what will they be like, what do we think of them. In the end, we always get a winner. Mm-hmm. And we always like the winner better than we thought we'd like the winner at the beginning. This time, mm-hmm. at this point, as we speak with Mr. Trump and Ms. Clinton, the world doesn't much like either one of them very much.
Right.
They're not in love with either one of them very much. And yet, by the time we get to the end, we'll like one of them more than we do now by rejecting the other one.
Mm-hmm.
And that tends to create more positiveness. The other thing that you can say that's very clear if you look at the data is that in years when we elect a Republican, returns in that election year tend to be above normal, and in the inaugural year after, below normal. In years when we elect a Democrat, in the election year they tend to be below normal, and in the inaugural year above average. The two-year returns are almost identical if you put them together.
Hmm.
But the timing of them is different, and I think there the why is because there's a lot of hope traditionally in our culture that the Republican will be pro-business, pro-markets, pro-growth, anti-regulatory, we all know.
Right.
And then in the inaugural year we find out he, and I say he because they've always been he's,
mm-hmm.
is just a politician, can't do as much as they thought, isn't as, and we get disappointed. With a Democrat,
right.
there's fear that they're anti-growth, anti-markets, anti-business, and then in the inaugural year, we find out that he, in the past, and maybe she this time, is just a politician, can't do as much, doesn't have the power, isn't as bad as was feared, and we get that positive surprise. I think this time we're likely to get a surprise either way, because I think that probably works if Ms. Clinton's elected.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it probably works as if it was a Democrat if Mr. Trump's elected, because so much of the conventional world that would hope for standardness from
mm-hmm.
a Republican nominee
mm-hmm.
doesn't see that in Mr. Trump. There's
right.
so much fear about Mr. Trump that probably, you know, Ronald Reagan would say if you're really capable as president, you can probably get three important things done in your first 4 years. That's if you're really capable.
Right.
And if you put too much effort into all the little stuff, you don't get those three things done. And if you're not real capable, you may not get much of anything done. If you speak to that, when you think about Mr. Obama as president, the two big signature items of his first 4 years are the health care bill
mm-hmm.
and Dodd-Frank.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And if you look at that in terms of legislation otherwise in the first 4 years, it's pretty much nothing. It's all
mm-hmm.
little stuff, nothing
mm-hmm.
big. That's pretty typical. That's about the most you can hope for. If you go to President Clinton, for example, in his first 2 years, you can't find much of anything in the first 2 years. The attempted health care that
mm-hmm.
failed.
Right.
And the tax increase,
mm-hmm.
which butchered him. And nothing else legislatively in the first 2 years, and he lost Congress, so he couldn't do anything in the back 2 years. That's also pretty normal. And my point would be that likely, if Mr. Trump prevails, and of course, as we speak right now, you know, they're within in a four-way race with the third-party candidates. They're 2% away from each other in the polls, so it's very close.
Mm-hmm.
So theoretically, either could win quite readily, and I don't know who will win.
You don't think it's going to be that close?
I didn't say it'd be that close. Right now, I said it's that close. Uh-huh. So therefore, I mean, one of them's going to win.
Right.
We always get a winner, right? Mr. Johnson's not going to win.
Right.
It's going to be Mr. Trump or Ms. Clinton, mm-hmm. and I don't have a clue which is going to win. It's going to go to the stronger campaigner, however that's defined, at the end. And Mr. Trump, of course, is very unconventional. Ms. Clinton is pretty darn conventional. What prevails? I don't know. At the beginning of the year, I came to the view that everybody that's tried to figure Trump has done it so badly that there was no point in me trying to figure Trump.
Right.
Trump will figure himself. And whether he wins or loses, I don't know. Mm-hmm. But I think if he prevails, he's likely to be received like a Democrat in the election year, which then likely leads to that positive surprise in the inaugural year where they find out that he can't actually do as much as the people who are. I mean, I've never seen in my lifetime so many Republicans campaigning as aggressively against the Republican nominee right. as you see this mm-hmm. time, and they're likely to find in the inaugural year that he can't do as much as. Mm-hmm. Now, I got a whole different view on almost everything, so you know I might be wrong about that. But you take his wall. Now, my view of a wall, he says mm-hmm. that he wants to build a wall 35 to 40 feet tall.
Right.
And most walls that you build, you do kind of with some steel mm-hmm. or some concrete. I think it'd be expensive to do it out of glass and silly out of glass. You know, you can break glass.
Right.
The part is steel and concrete. So you take a 35, 40-foot wall and you plop it on its side on the ground and it looks a lot like a freeway. And he wants to do 1,000 miles of it, he says. Well, you know, in the 1950s, we built thousands and thousands and thousands of miles of freeway. Just like that, we afforded them. And I thought it was a pretty good thing at the time. Those freeways, I think they were all pretty useful. And you got some of them right around here in Texas.
Uh-huh.
And we've put them in most of the states. And the reality is the cost isn't that high, and the negative side effects, I don't know. But if Mr. Trump's elected and he really prevails in doing that, that's one out of his two or three things. There's not that much more that can be done. People overfear presidents. They think the POTUS is a bigger deal than the POTUS really is.
Uh-huh.
That's why we have the kind of government which many people bemoan, because we don't really want in the short-term interests, whether it's Ms. Clinton's or Mr. Trump's or anybody else's, to get too carried away and too far down the track. That's why we have the judicial system. That's why we have mm-hmm. both branches of Congress. It's all aimed to not have society go too heavy and fast off the tracks.
So you're not too worried either way.
I'm mm-hmm. not. I think Ms. Clinton's pretty conventional, and I think Mr. Trump is. I'm personally, I know Mr. Trump a little bit,
mm-hmm.
I just believe that if he's president, he will not be able, and he will know then. I don't think there's any good preparation for being president of the United States.
Right.
And when Ms. Clinton says she knows, she's seen, she's been there, it's not like sitting in the seat. This is a little mm-hmm. bit like being, what her experience is, of which I have no criticism, is a little bit like being at ringside at boxing matches.
Right.
Maybe even with your spouse being the boxer.
Mm-hmm.
That's a little different than being in the ring and doing the fight, right?
It's
a little different than being in the ring doing the fight. And when you get in that ring and, you know, you're punching and the others punch back at you, there's no prior training for that. Mm-hmm. And I don't think Mr. Trump or Ms. Clinton will be able to actually do as much as they think they can do.
Well, it'll be interesting, and I really appreciate giving insight on this. And I don't want to make you talk too much because I know you still have a whole speech to give, and I really appreciate you answering my questions. And
my pleasure. Delighted.
Thank you.
And I hope it's useful to you and to your students.
It will be, and thank you, Ken Fisher.
Innovative Ed brings more than 75 years of varied leadership and education experience to assist your domestic organization. Find out how public and educational institutions can grow businesses from zero revenue to six figures in less than 4 years. Innovative Ed provides leadership and corporate training, consulting, strategic planning, process improvement, resource allocation efficiency, and effective decision-making modeling. For education institutions, we can help with accreditation compliance, strategic planning, resource allocation, and creating a value proposition afforded by technology convergence. To learn more, go to innovativeed.com. That's Innovative Ed with one E.
I'm Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I am here with John Tamny. John, I'm going to let you give everybody your title, because I know it's changed. I want to make sure I get it correct. Could you tell
sure.
everybody?
I'm a senior fellow in economics at Reason Foundation. I'm also editor of Real Clear Markets. I'm a senior economic advisor to Toreador Research and Trading. And with books in mind, I'll mention that I'm the author of Popular Economics, which came out in 2015, which simplifies economics for anyone. And then Who Needs the Fed in 2016, which simplifies the Federal Reserve and shows why it's not very economically consequential.
Well, thank you. And I know we've worked together because of our Forbes connection, and it was really nice of you to talk to us today. I love that we're in a room filled with wine. You want to just a quick interview?
That's right. Crack something open.
Crack something open. But it is a nice background. I like to get just to the basics because I like to use some of these for students to know more about the topics that our speakers have. And I'm curious if you can just start with the basics. What's the Fed and why is it important?
Well, the Fed was founded in 1913 as a lender of last resort to solvent banks. And so if you were a very well-run bank and you'd made very good loans, but you had a near-term cash crunch, maybe loan flow hadn't come in at the right time, you could go to the Fed and pledge your assets and get a loan. It just was a way to help banks that were already well-run and keep them in operation. That was its initial, very limited mandate.
And does it do the same thing now?
Well, that's what I point out in the book. What we've seen over the past 100-plus years is that it's unheard of for a well-run bank to go to the Fed for a loan. And the reason for that is if you're a really solid bank and you have a near-term cash crunch, there are voluminous market sources willing to lend to you, to tide you over, just like they would lend to any business. And so what we've seen is that the Fed has existed as a lender of last resort to insolvent or poorly run banks, propping up the weakest banks. Now, thinking about that in a bigger picture, imagine if Hollywood did that. Imagine if Hollywood kept on making Lindsay Lohan movies, even though her career has gone south. It would weaken the industry in total. Or think about Silicon Valley. What if there were a central authority constantly propping up web vans and other failed internet companies from the past? If so, it would be a very poor place. And so my argument in the book is that the Fed has become a huge detriment to the health of the banking system simply because it only exists to prop up the weakest.
So you say, as I recall in your book, that there haven't been new banks starting in long time, right? We've had just basically no growth in that area. Do you think that we're going to lose banks? Do you think we're going to start seeing more funding from private individuals, Kickstarter things, you know what I'm talking about, more of that type of lending in the future? Is that what you're forecasting?
You know my book so well, and you hit on the essential point. Banks are so overregulated. The system itself is so weakened that only one new banking company has been incorporated since 2010. It's called a Bird in Hand Bank. It's based in Amish country in Pennsylvania. So you're hitting on the essential truth that the banking system is weakening, is rushing toward irrelevance before our eyes. But you're also hitting on the other hugely important point, that it doesn't really matter. I've got nothing against banks. But what we're seeing is that sources of finance are everywhere. They're Kickstarter, there's Lending Club, which is basically Uber for lending. There are all these different sources of finance that are going to fill in where banks can no longer be a relevant source of credit. So the economy is going to be fine. There's this myth that we can't survive without banks. In fact, market forces have been pushing banks into irrelevancy for over 100 years, and this is going to continue and the economy will be fine.
Well, if you go to these lending sites, they're looking at your background, your history, what you bring to the table, and they rate you, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so what about the guy or gal that's trying to start out some new company and they don't have a good background, they don't have all of the, they don't have, you know, the money to make money or the good credit? Will they still be able to get the funding they need if they want to start out?
Well, it's an interesting question. What I'd first say is that banks generally wouldn't touch the person you describe in the first place. Banks are risk averse, and by nature, they are lending out money. They don't have equity in their loans, and so they can't take big risks on that person coming up. And that's the beauty of all these alternative sources of funding, because market actors can say, okay, for the people, for the individual who wants to start up a small business but's got no track record, what is the cost? What will you savers? What will you charge for that person to get credit? And so you will have the lending clubs of the world. So for those who say, I want my savings to attain a higher yield, or there will be market actors, and there already are market actors, we call them high yield bonds. There's a way to get more expensive funding to those who don't have credit. But what's important is banks could never touch those who didn't have a credit history realistically in the first place. And so what you're describing is very important. Mm-hmm. Other market actors are going to fulfill this need.
Well, I worked in subprime before it went down, let's say. Mm-hmm. The thought process back then was, you know, they had poor credit, but eventually they could fix their credit, they'd get a house. The house would increase in value, they refinance, they get out of the loan that was going to go high interest rate, and they'd be fine. Mm-hmm. But that, of course, didn't happen when everything was too much supply on the market, and you know how it went from there. Mm-hmm. How can you predict something like that? Did you foresee that happening with the housing?
What I argue in popular economics is no one predicted it. Mm-hmm. A lot of people said, wait, this seems abnormal. Mm-hmm. There's something wrong with this. But what I point out is that if you predicted the financial crisis, you're lying, because the financial crisis was a function of intervention, what was healthy. Banks and all sorts of financial institutions make bad loans all the time. And sometimes they go out of business, and that's healthy. That's how an economy evolves, is that we push out the bad in favor of the good. Interesting about subprime in a broad sense is that, of course, there's subprime when it comes to housing. With housing, it's not a risky loan. Mm-hmm. Because at the very least, you've got an asset, something that you can touch, that you can go repossess. Phil Knight, the founder of Nike, in his book Shoe Dog, which came out in the past year, when he was building up, when he started Nike, bank credit was near impossible for him to get. Every month it was this constant fight to stay solvent because banks did not trust what became Nike. Mm-hmm. But when he went to that same bank to get a home loan, it was easy.
Yeah.
Snap. Because it's a low risk loan. And that's what we have to remember about banks, is that of course they're involved in housing. It's less risky. But to show you what's happening to banks, they can't even compete in mortgages today. They're even losing market share there. The sources of mortgage lending are moving away from the banking system.
It's interesting, all the things you touch on mortgage. You touch on so many things in your book. I didn't know quite what to ask you because you had so much in there, and it's great to hear different perspectives. I'm curious, how popular is your side of this, whether we need the Fed or not? Or is it controversial, ideas about this?
Yes, very controversial.
For what reason?
Because I'm telling those who think the Fed is the worst thing that ever happened to the United States that you're missing the point. And I'm telling those who think the Fed is this amazing, essential thing for economic growth, I'm saying both sides are wrong. Mm-hmm. My argument is that the Fed's not very consequential. The Fed's channel through which it presumes to influence the U.S. economy is the U.S. banking system. U.S. banks account for 15% of total lending, as I point out in the book, but that number is in free fall. And it's in free fall because banks are so overregulated today, they just are not competitive, dynamic sources of credit. And so with banks declining as a relevant source of credit, where's the Fed's influence? My take is that, of course, we should end the Fed. It serves no useful purpose. But even if we don't, market forces are ending the Fed for us. It just doesn't matter nearly as much as people think. And that's controversial because both sides say it's either awful or essential.
And how long do you think we have before the Fed is gone then?
My belief is that it will never be gone. And there's a reason for that. Politicians love to have a convenient whipping boy, whether it's people in Congress, the Senate, or the President. They love whenever there's an economic slowdown, they can say, oh, look, the Fed caused this. Mm-hmm. So it's a perfect whipping boy to blame all of our economic problems on a central bank, once again dealing with banks that are the opposite of dynamic, that have really not much of an impact on the overall economy. So we're always going to have the Fed. Now, that's bad news for those who think it's essential to end it. But again, my argument is that market forces are going to do for us what Congress and the President will never do. they're rendering the Fed irrelevant simply because they are rendering banks irrelevant.
Well, you bring up a few things in the book that help, I think, make it a little more sexy to picture your argument and to tie people in to what they can relate to in terms of bringing in robots and Uber and Taylor Swift and, mm-hmm. and to make it more to the common person could understand how to relate to it. What does Taylor Swift turning down the deal that Apple wanted to give away her music and that type of thing, what does that have to do with the Fed?
It has everything to do with it because it has everything to do with credit. Mm-hmm. Basically, Apple Music offered new subscribers 3 months of free access to the music on mm-hmm. the system, and Taylor Swift said, okay, you're welcome to do that. You just won't be streaming my music. You're not mm-hmm. giving away my hard work for free. And it's a reminder that if you want to make borrowing accessible, if you want to make access to credit accessible, you've got to please those who have the credit in the first place, the savers first. Taylor Swift had access to the music, but if Apple was going to give it away for free, they weren't going to give away her music. Look at the Fed. The Fed, in its infinite unwisdom, when it wants to make credit easy, it lowers the rate to zero. That's the equivalent of saying to Taylor Swift, oh, we don't care the work you went into, we're just going to give it away for free. And that's the equivalent of saying to savers, oh, you don't matter in this equation, we're going to give away your hard work for free. Well, no saver is going to sit back and give something away for nothing, and neither is Taylor Swift. And so even if you support the Fed, its models of making credit accessible are 100% backwards.
Well, I think that there's a lot to be learned from what all the other information you put in your book about Silicon Valley and all the failures that we see. Now, did I read it correctly that you think failure is a good thing? That we,
yes.
And the FailCon and all that was to promote what we learned from that? And why would FailCon end? And if you could touch on that a little bit, I'd like to.
Well, FailCon is this annual gathering that mm-hmm. used to take place in Silicon Valley where people who'd overseen a startup that had imploded would mm-hmm. get together and talk about their experiences, and
right.
it was a networking opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
But failure is so constant in Silicon Valley, just about every startup ever created there didn't survive, that they stopped doing it just because everyone in Silicon Valley has at least one failure on their resume, and it's not a bad thing.
Too many people.
It's a source of its health, because the only way you can get economic progress is through failure. Mm-hmm. Through a poorly run business, you first of all see what not to do wrong in the future, but also it's when businesses fail that precious assets, and that could be human beings, that could be office space, that could be computers, routers, you name it, are released to other businesses so that they can go on their path, hopefully, to success. And so the failure is part of economic growth. It's where we don't allow failure that there's stagnation and slow growth. Mm-hmm. You need to have that constant experimentation that leads to success.
Well, I know you mentioned that Steve Jobs, a lot of his failures, I mean, there's been a lot of famous failures of people that have ended up being very successful. And if it were not for Bill Gates, he may not have gotten a loan. And
mm-hmm.
Do you have failures that you regret, or if all your failures, have you had any? And do you have anything you would have done differently?
Oh, I'm so relieved. I don't think I was particularly good on Wall Street, and thank goodness I wasn't, because it forced me to get into something that I really enjoy, which mm-hmm. is writing about economics. One of my favorite examples of it is Ben Affleck. He was once asked by Barbara Walters, mm-hmm. Would you redo your past, the riding mm-hmm. around in Bentleys with Jennifer Lopez and those bad movies, Geely mm-hmm. and Jersey Girl that you made? And he said, no way. Mm-hmm. The failures are what made me. Ben Affleck's failures rendered him unbankable in Hollywood. He could no longer get a movie made. And so what did it force him to do? It forced him to become a director.
Mm-hmm.
So he went from a Hollywood joke to an Academy Award winning director of a best picture. It's the failures that teach you what you're doing wrong, that remind you that you've got to fix certain problems. And so it helps. It's good for an individual and it's good for businesses. You need that constant teaching. Jeff Bezos of Amazon, one of the things he loves so much about the Kindle and also the Amazon Echo is that they're both popular.
Mm-hmm.
And what that means is there's this huge inflow of revenues that he can spend on all sorts of experiments, most of which will fail. Mm-hmm. But that's his path to success, always experimenting. Thomas Edison had voluminous failures to get to one success. He felt he was achieving if during a day he made a lot of mistakes, because it brought him closer to where he wanted to get to.
Well, it'll be interesting, because you talked about Amazon in your book, that they don't have to make the profits that people want because they know what's coming in the future. Do you see the same thing for Uber, that people are continuing to invest? I meant Tesla. Do you see people continuing to invest in companies just for what they think is going to be down the road more than what they're getting right now?
Oh, yeah, of course. It could be that investors decide that Tesla just doesn't have mm-hmm. the proper plan for long-term success. But what we see in a country like the United States is that you don't have to have a lot of earnings now to attract investment. Investors mm-hmm. are very patient, which is contrary to what we hear. We hear that, oh, the U.S. is a quarterly earning society. Oh, please. Mm-hmm. American investors and investors in the United States are the most patient in the world. Again, Silicon Valley, just about everything dies. Elon Musk is a constant experimenter. A lot of his ideas will fail, too. Mm-hmm. Investors are okay with that if they like where you're going, if they like where you're taking this. And so just as Amazon was able to have losses for many, many years, Tesla will. Any mm-hmm. company with a good idea can sustain losses for a long time if investors see the long-term end game, which is one of major success and profits.
So let's say you had 60 seconds in front of our students that want to be future leaders, and what you've learned from everything you've gone through and what you've written about in your books, what advice would you give them if they wanted to maybe start their own business, or be an entrepreneur, be a leader of another company? Do you have any words of wisdom for my students?
My words of wisdom, and this is somewhat of a cliche, but you really need to find what it is that you think elevates your own individual talents. Mm-hmm. We live in a country and increasingly a world where you can make money as a doggy dietitian, as a sommelier, as a video gamer. Right. Find what it is that you couldn't stand not doing, that it would pain you not to do, because that's the only way you'll ever be good at something. And it is because that's the only, unless you find something that you really love, you're not going to be that hard of a worker. Right. You may be able to sustain hard work for a year or two, but ultimately it's going to break you down. But if you find what you love, and we live in a country where people can combine passion with work, look for it, maybe get fired a few times because you haven't found what it is, but find what that is that would pain you not to do, because then you'll never work again a day in your life. As cliched as that sounds, right. It is true.
Right. Well, great advice to end on, and thank you for being here, John Tamny.
Are you an aspiring entrepreneur? Startup professionals can help you through the initial phases of dealing with an increasing number of business unknowns, which may be outside your area of expertise. Marty Zwilling, founder and CEO, can help you with some of your most challenging issues, including how to write an investment-grade business plan, how to attract investors and secure funding, how to select advisory board members, how to create a financial model, how to incorporate a business, how to protect the concept, when and how to file patents, how to find management employees. The Startup Professionals team has extensive startup experience in all these areas. Let them help you make your business dreams a reality without breaking your budget. To reach Marty and his team at Startup Professionals, call 480-789-1621. Check out their website at startupprofessionals.com or email him personally at marty@startupprofessionals.com.
I'd like to thank both Ken Fisher and John Tamny for being on my show. Both of them are just so interesting. I found both of the interviews so unique and insightful, and I hope to have both of them back someday. But I did think that it was unique to get different perspectives from them on topics that aren't maybe with Ken, maybe his usual things he talks about, and with John, just to see that, you know, he's got some controversial topics, and I think it's really interesting to talk to him from all sides on that. So I hope you enjoyed the show. I know I did, and I look forward to the next edition of Take the Lead Radio.